Hello and welcome to Dental Studies Simplified. I am Dr. Ankita Kotecha and today's topic is non-specific plaque hypothesis in detail. I'll be dealing with this topic under the following subheadings, that is introduction, who gave the hypothesis and when, the core concept, drawbacks and applied aspects. So to begin with, Miller in the year 1890 gave non-specific plaque hypothesis. And the core concept of this hypothesis focuses on the quantity of the plaque, that is, the amount of plaque that accumulates over the period of time in conjunction with diminished host response and increased host susceptibility due to aging, altogether contributes to periodontal disease. So according to this hypothesis, all plaque are equally pathogenic and all microorganisms are equally capable of causing periodontal disease and the host response is uniform. It says, plaque releases noxious products which creates a host response and hence the disease. So if we say plaque is less, then less noxious products are released and the body will be able to neutralize them. So no disease. But if plaque is more, more noxious products are released and hence the body will be unable to neutralize them and so the disease will occur. So this is how they justify the quantity of plaque as a rule in periodontal diseases. Coming to the contradictory findings, the drawbacks associated with this hypothesis. Number one, patients presented with lots of plaque, calculus and gingivitis as well, but never developed periodontitis. And patients who developed periodontitis showed site specificity. Site specificity means certain teeth, certain sites showed full-fledged disease activity, whereas certain teeth or sites were absolutely disease-free or clinically healthy. If we accept this hypothesis saying all plaque are equally pathogenic and the host response is uniform, then how to justify these drawbacks, these contradictory findings? This led to renewed search for specific factors, specific microorganisms in the plaque which contributes to the pathogenicity of plaque. And this led to the introduction of our next hypothesis, that is specific plaque hypothesis. Coming to the applied aspects, our current standard periodontal therapy is still based on non-specific plaque hypothesis. That is removal of local factors. Whenever we do any standard periodontal therapy, let's say non-surgical periodontal therapy, that is scaling and root planing, or surgical debridement, we always aim at removal of local factors, that is plaque and calculus. That is what is meant by the applied aspects of this hypothesis, that is our current standard periodontal therapies, non-surgical and surgical, are based on non-specific plaque hypothesis. Although this hypothesis is discarded in favor of newer hypothesis, our current standard periodontal therapy is still based on non-specific plaque hypothesis. So that's all for non-specific plaque hypothesis. A quick summary, Miller in the year 1890 gave non-specific plaque hypothesis, the core concept of which focuses on the quantity of the plaque, the amount of the plaque. The applied aspects of which are current standard periodontal therapy, both non-surgical and surgical as well. Owing to the drawbacks that are before mentioned, like patients who had plaque, calculus and gingivitis as well but never developed periodontitis, or patients who developed periodontitis showed site specificity. Owing to such contradictory findings, such drawbacks, a search for another hypothesis continued and we get our next hypothesis, that is specific plaque hypothesis. So this completes the topic non-specific plaque hypothesis. I hope you find this helpful and the topic is clear to you. If you still have any doubts or any queries, please feel free to write them in the comment section below or mail it at dentalstudiessimplified@gmail.com. Like my video, share it with your friends and colleagues. Subscribe to my channel to get notification of my upcoming videos. Thank you for watching and listening to me. Study well. Have a good day.